Wait, before you scroll away, unless you want to be drinking sheep turds and swimming in your own sewage, you should really stick with me here. Now, to show you I'm serious, I may not be Margot Robbie explaining the stock market in the bath, but I'm going to explain to you why water infrastructure matters in the freezing cold waters of the Wellington Harbour. We take for granted what goes into making sure that clean water comes out of our taps and our poo goes away when we flush the toilet. But underneath New Zealand, there's 88,000 kilometres of pipes transporting all of that. That's enough to wrap around the planet more than twice. Not to mention the water and sewage treatment facilities, the reservoirs, the pumping stations, the stormwater systems. I mean, when you think about it, it's a mind-boggling amount of infrastructure that our lives would fundamentally change without. But for decades, we've been underfunding how much it costs to maintain and upgrade these systems. And as a result, they're failing. You've probably heard of the Three Waters proposal, one idea of how we could deal with this. But for the last 3 years, we've argued about everything except water infrastructure.
And now the new government plans to scrap the Three Waters proposal, but the problems still remain.
So today we're going to mostly ignore all of that and just look at what water infrastructure is, how it benefits all of us, and how we can make sure that for us and future generations, our poo continues to go away when we flush the toilet.
Because we haven't been investing in our infrastructure, the infrastructure that we've got is degrading. It's beginning to fail, and without investment, it's going to get worse. We'll see more leakages on the streets, you'll see more gushing geysers of water, and that might go into, you know, your river or your lake or your harbour where you're going to swim or where you're going to collect your seafood. With climate change, we're going to see increased sea level rise, more strong storm events. If we aren't able to manage that, we're going to end up with more flooding. Between 125 billion and 185 billion is required to be invested in New Zealand's water infrastructure over the next 30 years. That's at least a double, if not a treble, of what we spend on an annual basis on water. Those figures don't include any amount for climate change.
Our water infrastructure can be broken down into three categories, i.e. the three waters. That's drinking water, wastewater, and stormwater. That water system starts at the source, like a river, lake, or aquifer under the ground. From there it's collected and taken to a water treatment facility where it's filtered and treated so it's safe to drink. That's then transported through a network of pipes and supplies all the water in your home, from your tap to your shower and toilet. But once any of that water goes down the drain, it becomes wastewater. Another series of pipes then transport that to a wastewater treatment facility, where any solids are filtered out and the remaining water treated so that it's harmless before being discharged back into the environment. Alongside those systems is stormwater, a series of drains, gutters, and pipes that's meant to make sure all the water that falls from the sky is collected and dispersed before it floods our communities.
A big issue with New Zealand's pipe network is age. The average age of our pipes is 45 years old, with some sections as old as 120 years. And that's partly why we lose a fifth of all the water we treat to leaks. And last year, there was over 4,000 sewage overflows across the country. Hey mate.
Hey Baz, how you going?
Marnie Prickett is a researcher at the University of Otago who studies the impact water quality is having on our health.
Right now, people can sort of trust that they turn the water on, good, clean drinking water should come out, they flush their toilet, their poo goes away, but if we don't improve our systems well enough, like, we probably just can't trust that that'll be the case forever, right?
A lot of people can't trust that that's the case at the moment. You know, we've got lots of sewage overflows. Auckland is a classic for that. You know, every time it rains, and it doesn't have to be particularly heavy rain, you get overflows of sewage going into the beaches, and there's other parts of the country where that's really common, including Wellington as well. Drinking water, I think people kind of maybe think that's a little bit more reliable, but when it goes wrong, it can go really, really wrong, like Havelock North.
Can you explain what happened in Havelock North?
Havelock North, 2016, there was some heavy rain in combination with a badly maintained bore and sheep feces that flowed off the ground down into the bore and contaminated that water supply. The estimate is between 6,000 to 8,000 people got really sick. They got Campylobacter, which is a horrible gastro bug. 42 people ended up in hospital. 4 people died from complications of getting that bug. It was a really big deal, and I had hoped that it was kind of a wake-up call for people that we really needed to be thinking about our water infrastructure a little bit more, but the conversation about three waters has really gotten dragged away from those kind of fundamental public health issues and into nastier places.
Far out. Can you paint a bit of a picture of what drinking water will look like for everyday New Zealanders if we don't invest in the treatment facilities?
What it will look like is probably riskier water supplies. You know, at the moment we've got about 34,000 people a year get sick from drinking water, but that could increase if our drinking water treatment facilities are just much more under pressure. Maybe intermittent supplies as well. It's not just going to be a question of more water hitting our systems, it's going to be a question of less water too. So in some parts of the country, drought's going to be a real threat to people's drinking water supplies as well. Just a harder life. Drinking water is something that a lot of us take for granted, but not having drinking water for a few days, you feel that. Water is just so an everyday necessity in everything that we do.
This failing infrastructure is also breaking our connection with the ocean. Sewage overflows have made these signs warning against swimming or collecting seafood a common sight across Aotearoa. Porirua local Pani Array has started a petition to get local agencies to address sewage overflows in her community. There's been almost 2,000 sewage spills here in the past 5 years, and she says over the past 50 years, the wastewater system has destroyed her iwi's connection with their moana.
Rukutane Point is just around the corner, and Rukutane Point is where the wastewater treatment plant disposes of all the water, and it just, with the tide, it just goes boom, back into the beach. All the rocks, they're all mahinga kai spots, and that's where like a lot of our power can shellfish come from. Mm-hmm. Well, they used to come from, but this whole area, nah, not anymore.
So you guys wouldn't feel safe to eat the kaimoana from around here anymore?
Nah, not at all. I know, it's hard to describe, because like, our people love kaimoana, and like, our people have always eaten kaimoana because we're a coastal people, and it's like a sense of pride. Like, when you're at the marae, if you're at a tour marae, this should be kaimoana, because we're a coastal iwi. Like, that's how we show our manaaki, but like, this is where we get it from, and there's the potential that we could get sick, or our manuhiri could get sick, and it looks bad on us.
How does it feel?
It feels like shit. I love kaimoana. I love powers, I love kinas, I love mussels, I love any kind of fish, oysters, everything. And like, we should be able to get it here, but we can't. And it's like, that's my right. That's my right as a Māori. I should be allowed to eat my seafood.
How does it feel to be disconnected from your own moana like that?
It hurts. It hurts in a way that I don't think I can describe, because my iwi were always described as being on the water. That's what we did. We were always on the water. We were like fishermen. And there's a lot of knowledge around that that I don't think my people will ever get back. And that it will never be something that I could pass down to my kids. Because I never got the opportunity to learn.
Our water systems aren't coping well now, and there are even bigger challenges on the horizon. We saw firsthand how our stormwater systems, and also our drinking water and wastewater systems, were overwhelmed by the Auckland floods and Cyclone Gabrielle this year. And climate change means those extreme weather events could just be a taster of what's to come.
This field in Northcote, Auckland's a great example of the wins we can experience when we address water infrastructure. It's designed to take all of the overflow water in the event of a storm. So when the floods happened here in Auckland in January, it actually completely filled up with several Olympic-sized swimming pools worth of water. And while it did end up breaking the banks, the surrounding community was spared a lot of the flooding that other suburbs in Auckland weren't. While this solution couldn't just be applied to every suburb in Auckland or every city in New Zealand, it's a good example of when you have the resources and opportunity to think differently about your water infrastructure, the kinds of wins the surrounding community can experience.
There seems to be no debate that our water systems need investment. So why is there so much resistance? James Goff is a Christchurch City Councillor and has been a staunch opponent of the Three Waters Reform proposal. Mostly because Christchurch has already made $6.9 billion of investment that other areas of New Zealand haven't.
I mean, yeah, you've spent the $6.9 billion, but isn't it a bit like a house? You know, you buy the house for a certain amount, you renovate it, but over time it degrades, right, to the point where it's pretty much a tear down. Isn't that the case with New Zealand's water infrastructure?
Yeah, Yeah, look, in a lot of cases that is true. I think Christchurch is a bit different because we were beneficiaries of multi-billion dollar investment program after the earthquake. So we've got hundreds of kilometres of new pipes and infrastructure under the ground. That's not to say that, you know, we don't deserve to do our fair share and be part of a solution where there are others who are not in that same position. But it's probably not all on Christchurch ratepayers to carry the can. We've done things pretty well for whatever reason.
One of the most contentious parts of the now scrapped Three Waters proposal was its inclusion of co-governance, which would give iwi equal representation to local councils.
Does the community oppose Three Waters for the same reason the council does?
I think some people in the community don't. There's some people that are oppose it for very intelligent reasons. I think there are some people that oppose it for very unintelligent reasons, sometimes, frankly, just racist reasons. I've seen it bring out, you know, some of the worst in people and some of the worst in communities, which I think is really sad because that's been a distraction to a really important conversation.
If everyone's on the same page that this needs done and urgently, like, how do we get to the point where we can just get it done?
Yeah, I totally agree with you. And I think that there is a real risk that what people are doing is kicking the can down the road, and it's been, you know, politicised, which means that people start talking at cross purposes and everyone's forgotten about what the whole issue was.
All the political parties are acknowledging that infrastructure in water, we need to increase the amount we're investing. I don't want to be coming here and having a conversation with you or somebody when I've got grey hair saying, you didn't listen. We have to seize the moment and make sure that we don't forget and we actually do the investment that's required.